Good morning, everybody. Welcome to the meeting of the Transportation Committee. Today is Tuesday, April 9th. I am Senator Tim Kennedy, Chair of the Senate Transportation Committee. I want to welcome you all today for the purpose of meeting to consider the nomination of Francis G. Hoare as Executive Director of the Thruway Authority. Welcome. For anybody that doesn't know Frank Hoare, I have known him for many years. He's a consummate public servant, and we've worked together in many different capacities over the years. He's been the acting leader of the Thruway Authority for quite some time now. I want to welcome Senator Hinchey, Senator Gallivan, and Senator Liu here. Is there a quorum?
There is a quorum.
We have a quorum. So with that said, I'd like to welcome Mr. Hoare to the committee and recognize him for any opening remarks.
Thank you, Senator. I will be brief. Thank you, Chairman, Senators. Thank you for this opportunity to appear before you on this, I know, very busy week. It is an honor to be nominated by Governor Kathy Hochul to serve as the Executive Director of the State Thruway Authority. Over the past 3+ years, I've had the privilege of working at the Thruway Authority beginning in December 2020 as the General Counsel. I was named in December of 2022 as the Interim Executive Director, and last July, Governor Hochul nominated me as acting executive director, subject to Senate confirmation as the permanent executive director. I'm humbled to be asked to lead the almost 1,800 professional, hardworking employees of the Thruway Authority. Their commitment, as well as the dedication of the Thruway Board of Directors, ensures that the Thruway is one of the safest and most reliable highways in the country. By way of background, I'm a lifelong New Yorker, born and raised in Washington Heights, to immigrant parents. I mention this because, like so many public servants in New York, my view of service was influenced by the values of my parents who came to this country seeking opportunity for a better life for their families. I learned from them the value of hard work, commitment, and God, family, and country. That has been my motivation in 24 years of state service and 28 years of military service. I began my government career in 1987, serving as the counsel to the chair of the Assembly Ways and Means Committee, the legendary Assemblyman Denny Farrell. After 11 years on Assembly staff, I worked in the Attorney General's Office, the Department of Homeland Security, Emergency Services, the Executive Chamber and Division of Military and Naval Affairs. My 28 years of military service includes both active and reserve duty, including 4 overseas deployments. I'm a proud graduate of the State University right here in Albany and of Albany Law School. As the acting executive director, I've led the authority through a total adjustment process. This initiative has resulted in increased investments towards modernizing and restoring our 70-year-old infrastructure. Additionally, we recently marked more than halfway completion in the $450 million public-private partnership with Apple Green to rebuild 23 of the Thruway's 27 service areas and make substantial renovations to the remaining 4. As a reminder, no toll or taxpayer funds are used in connection with this construction. Our other achievements include nearly doubling the availability of the high-speed EV chargers across the state for our customers and surpassing 1.1 billion successful cashless tolling transactions following the implementation of cashless tolling in 2020. We've seen tangible benefits to the life-saving implementation of the automated work zone speed enforcement program that the legislature passed, notably enhancing safety measures and reducing speeds within our work zones. This achievement is a tribute to all of you and your valuable support for this legislation. And on behalf of the workforce at the Thruway and their families, we thank you. That concludes my testimony, subject to your questions, and thank you for this opportunity to serve the state of New York.
Thank you very much, Mr. Hoare. I have some questions. Before I get to my questions, I'm going to open up to my colleagues, but I also want, if you could, just mention your military service to this country. I want to thank you for your service. Can you just speak to that, please?
Yes, I served 28 years in the U.S. Army Reserve. As a judge advocate general, so a lawyer in the military, and I retired in December of 2019 as a lieutenant colonel, and had a great opportunity to serve in uniform and see a lot of different parts of the world.
Thank you. Thank you again. And I bring it up just a couple of years ago, you would see Frank regularly in the halls, and all of a sudden he disappeared. And he disappeared because the United States government called him into action, and he went. So thank you again for your service. You. That said, I want to open it up to my colleagues before I ask a series of questions myself. Senator Gallivan.
Congratulations on your nomination, although you've been serving for, has it been about a year and a half? Is the interim or acting?
Coming up in a year and a half, yes.
A year and a half. So you're living through the rest area projects. Can you tell us the status of that now and when it'll be completed?
Yes, the status is that there are 15 completed, wholly rebuilt. 10 are closed currently and in various stages of reconstruction. Two are open but have not started construction. So we have 15 open as I sit here today. Another 3 will open by the July 4th weekend is expected. And then by the end of the year, by December 23 out of the 27 will be fully completed. By the end of this year, 23 out of the 27. The remaining 4 will be in 2025, and we're looking at October of 2025 for the project to be complete.
Are they meeting the needs of the motorists now?
Yes, I believe so. We've gotten good reviews. It was we had a rocky start, to be frank. I know that I discussed that with many of you. But that really, it wasn't with the quality of the service area itself. It was when the first couple have opened, they were crowded because so many were closed. But as we open each one, it's like a pressure valve. There are more opportunities to stop, so they get less and less crowded. But they're up and running. We've gotten good reviews on the amenities there in terms of the food vendors that are there, play areas. 4 out of the 27 will have amenities for truckers, meaning locker rooms, showers, washer dryers. So the Trucking Association is happy with that. And generally, in terms of the appearance, it's we've gotten good reviews that people feel it's open and airier and more light.
We talked before about the monies lost through people not paying the tolls, and it's a significant amount. I mean, tens of millions of what escapes me. Can you tell us a number again, but tell us what progress you're making in recovering it.
So it's an issue that's plaguing every single toll agency in the country. And we are losing, we approximated last year about $40 million. Most of that comes from out-of-state trucking companies. New Jersey, Ohio, Illinois are the big ones. So what we're doing to address that is, again, we're working collaboratively with our partners here in the state, MTA, Port, the Bridge Authority, to come up with solutions. We are talking to other states about reciprocity agreements. Right now we only have a reciprocity agreement with Massachusetts. That allows us to go to that state and suspend registrations for non-payment of tolls. We're in discussions with both Pennsylvania and New Jersey to get agreements there. Connecticut, Vermont are not interested because they don't have tolls, so they're not interested in pursuing their citizens. We're also looking, there's proposed legislation in the budget that would assist us and give us more tools to suspend registrations. The governor has in there a theft of services legal theory that would allow us to increase penalties and suspend registrations where we can work out the reciprocity agreements. So in sum, that's what we're working on. And of course, looking at ways that we can use technology to be more innovative and inventive in cutting down this. But it is a major issue. $40 million is a lot of miles in paving and a lot of reconstruction of bridges. When we have a bridge hit and we have to reconstruct it, it costs about $6 million. So right there, if we were collecting more of that revenue, that would just add to our capital program. And very simply, it's not fair to all those right. who are paying their tolls.
Couldn't the system essentially catch those out-of-state truckers through a notification to the state police?
We're talking to state police about doing just that, because we know when they come on the system, So again, a theft of services legal theory will give us that legal basis to do more of that.
That very narrow application.
Yes,
just vehicles from out of state.
That's right.
That are paying.
Right.
Okay, thank you.
We have a list of 20 companies that we are pursuing now with the Attorney General's help, listed 20 companies that are in excess of $200,000, trucking companies. So, you know, we're looking, you know, all these efforts for toll enforcement, we're not looking at the passenger vehicle and the person who owes $100, $200, right? It's our priority is going after these the big numbers. There's a company out of Montreal, $500,000in tolls that they owe us over the last few years. They're just not paying. So we're looking, you know, there are obstacles there with a company out of the country. But again, we're looking to pursue that and how we can crack down on that. Because again, we rely on toll revenue. 90% of our revenue comes from tolls, so we need that to keep the system going.
Thank you.
Also, thanks, Senator Galvin. I want to recognize Senator Persaud and Senator Fernandez, who have joined us. Senator Fernandez, fresh from a concert on the plaza yesterday. If you haven't seen it, yes, it was wonderful. Well, you'll have to wait another 55 years to see her next show.
Buy tickets to the next show.
Senator Hinchey.
Thank you. I have a couple of questions, but just following up on that, the goods that particularly the trucking company from Montreal, but the other ones as well, is New York a pass-through for them, or are they delivering goods to communities here? Do we know?
For the most part, they're pass-through. They're coming through New York and going south or going to the Northeast. But it's not the big, you know, it's not FedEx, UPS. It's not the known, the more popular ones we would know. It is smaller trucking companies that have, they're smaller, but they still have anywhere from 10 to 20 vehicles. So it's not one vehicle running up those numbers, right? It's a number of vehicles that are just running through our system.
Right. Thank you. A couple of thoughts. But first, thank you for being here and for your service. And thanks for the meetings that we've had over the last year and a half. I will say you are one of the few who, after our meeting, promptly give us back information that we discuss and ask for. So thank you.
Thanks to my Todd Gold and Sandra and the rest. Thank you.
Thank you for that. And it's been a pleasure working with you. I also want to thank you for the upgrades and construction that's happening now around Saugerties and Greene County. So the thruway for our district, as you know, in the 41st, the thruway runs right through the center of the west side of our district. And so it's a huge thoroughfare and really important both for travel but for our residents. So those upgrades will be great. We've talked about both of these things, but I'm just curious if there's an update on either of them. I chair agriculture. And one of the biggest things we hear both from the agricultural community as well as folks who live downstate is the desire and the need to get fresh food from upstate to our communities downstate, but there's a lot of logistical challenges. The thruway plays a really important role in delivering that service, but the costs can be very high to do it, as opposed to getting food from Connecticut or New Jersey, which is just a closer distance, right? And like Connecticut without tolls, it's a different kind of set of circumstances. So there's a number of bills in the legislature about making it more affordable for farm vehicles specifically to be able to travel into the city. It's coming a big point of conversation now, especially with congestion pricing coming, farm vehicles will be in that mix. And so what, if anything, is the thruway currently doing to help? I've heard talking about the need for more money from out-of-state trucking companies and the need for the thruway. We understand the toll process and why it's important. But is there an openness to having a more serious conversation around supporting agricultural vehicles in the delivery and transportation of food to our downstate communities?
Well, we've tried to work with that community and other business communities is in our having commercial programs. And discounts for the frequency that you use the thruway. When we have a legal challenge when we try and either, you know, say no tolls or relieve tolls because of our bond covenants and our authorities under both the Constitution, state Constitution, and the public authorities law. So what we try and do is craft that around commercial discounts. And we will continue to do that. There are a number of commercial discounts that we work with the agriculture community on to take advantage. And that's the approach we've taken in order to I don't say avoid, but in order to recognize the legal hurdles and legal challenges that we have.
Understood. I think I'd love to continue the conversation with you. Confirmed for a full term, because I think there's a number of different vehicles that don't classify currently or smaller types of farms. I think there's some more work that we could do in that space, recognizing the legalities that you have. So look forward to hopefully continuing that conversation going forward. And finally, this is another topic that we've talked about, but it's been a little while, so curious if there's an update. On the throughway, I know there's a contract with the state police, obviously, for the throughway. But at least in our district, many of our volunteer fire departments are the ones that respond first to calls if there's an accident or a fire or an issue. And those same departments are very small. They're pretty rural. And again, they're all volunteer. And they don't get any compensation. As far as I understand, there's no compensation structure for them when they go even out of their jurisdiction or serve the throughway, which pulls them out of then serving the community if there's only a couple people who are able to make it, again, volunteer to a call. So if there's something in Ruby, the local fire department could go to that, but then if there's an accident in our district or an EMS call, it makes it even more difficult. And so what is the status right now of conversations with some of those local departments, and how do we think we can make that better, those relationships and partnerships better?
Well, right now, the ambulance response to the throughway, they don't pay a toll. They're not charged for their toll.
I would hope so.
Right. So, and based on conversations that we had, we have talked to that community, and we've tried to streamline the process by which they sign up for that and then get reimbursed. So we've tried to try and make it as easy as possible for those ambulance and emergency service companies, because we recognize that they're volunteers. There's not a lot of people working with them, and when they are there working, they're providing services, right? That's their focus. So we will continue to work with them to make it as easy as possible for them to get reimbursed for their tolls.
Right, which I think is great, but again, if they're being called to an accident on the throughway, it's another community, they shouldn't be paying a fee.
Right.
So that's, to me, great, but the bare minimum, right, that we could be doing to help, right? Because of course they shouldn't be paying that fee. In the similar way that there's a contract with the state police to provide services that you need on the thoroughfare, in my thought, mm-hmm, there should be something similar for those in our community who are providing services that the throughway needs for folks who are traveling that throughway, often not our residents. So I hope we can continue that conversation.
So that would
well.
Be to pay them, not only reimburse toll, but to pay them for their time.
As an idea.
Okay.
All set, Senator Henshey. Thank you so much. Senator Liu.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And thank you, Mr. Hoare. I just wanted to follow up on some statements you've made during the budget hearings. Correct me if my recollection is inaccurate, but I think you've talked about how the toll rates in the state of New York are lower than what you would see in other states, and you suggested that was making things difficult for your agency and we might need to see more toll increases?
No, the toll rates are lower here. For example, in New York is about 14 cents per mile, mm-hmm, versus in New Jersey it's approximately 31 cents. Mm-hmm. So I think those comments were made when asked about the need for last year's. There was a toll adjustment that went into effect this past January 1st, a two-part, one January 1st, 24, the next one will be January 1st of 2027. So I believe it was in the context of responding to questions about the need for a toll increase. We talked about that there had not been a toll increase in 14 years. And obviously prices have gone up dramatically in those years.
But so has volume, right? So has traffic volume.
Traffic volume has gone up.
So right. that would indicate an increase in tolls also.
Our toll revenue has increased in the last couple of years. But from that toll increase that went into effect January 1st, we estimate will bring in between $90 and $100 million. All that money is directed into our capital program. Mm-hmm. So our capital program this year, we're able to raise it from $350 to up to $451 million will be spent this year in capital, you know, to paving, reconstructing.
Yeah, I mean, that's what people would expect the toll revenue to be primarily used for. I mean, I would just submit, and this is my impression during the budget hearing as well, a comparison to New Jersey, which is a much smaller and much denser state, is probably not the right comparison to judge New York State tolls by. There are other states much larger, much more far-flung. And so I'm just asking you to just, you know, try to keep a line on the tolls.
Yes, well, the tolls will not be going up for the foreseeable future. We have the adjustment that went into effect, so well into the 2030s.
No toll increases and more construction, more capital improvements on the tolls, on the throughway.
That's what we're looking at.
The best of both worlds.
$2.4 billion in the next 5 years will be spent.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you.
Any other questions from my colleagues? Okay, thank you. Mr. Hoare, thank you for those comments and responses. Actually, my colleagues answered a number of questions that I had, so I appreciate them interjecting. Let me ask you a few more key questions. I'm going to bring it hyper-local for a moment out in the region of Western New York that I represent. There's a lot of discussion about our community lacking attention to the needs of the thruway system, which is vast. You have the 190, the 90, the 290. They also intersect in many ways with the Department of Transportation thoroughfares, which I'll get to that question in a minute. But how can the community in Western New York be confident that it'll get its fair share of attention to help the needs of the system in the region moving forward, especially with this new influx of capital dollars?
We're committed to, the governor's committed to making sure the board is diverse in all sense of that word, so particularly geographically. So there's efforts to, we have two vacancies on the throughway. There's an effort to fill those vacancies with somebody from your part of the state. Last year you appointed a new board member from Rochester, but we recognize that we need to go west of there. So those efforts are underway.
So with one of the vacancies, we should expect a Western New York representative?
That's our hope.
Great. Music to my ears. We've been talking about it. The governor and I have been talking about it. I'm confident in it as well. I wanted to hear it again. But then the needs of the system. The capital needs. There's often talk from the industry. This isn't things that we're just conjuring up, but you know, the traveling public on the 290 every day as it intersects with the 90 in Amherst, the Blue Water Tower there. Traffic is snarled on a regular basis. There's certainly need to address that interchange. And for years, the industry leadership has been really clamoring for this to be on a list of priorities that the Thruway Authority is addressing with their capital plan. Is that something that you can commit to?
We're committed to spending, addressing the capital needs of Western New York and in the areas you're talking about. I will look at whether the 290 project, where that is, looking at that. Some of these roads are state roads, meaning DOT, and other local roads. So anything we do is always in partnership and collaboration with those other agencies, as you know, because it's obvious, right? They all run into each other.
Of course. I would ask you to make that issue a priority, not the only priority. And again, you know the issues. You know Western New York. We've worked together a long time. Because of the vastness of the system and the lane miles of the system, particularly in the western part of the state, I would just ask you to pay particular attention to that neck of the woods when you're coming up and determining the focus of your capital plan moving forward. That said, you mentioned the systems, and I mentioned the systems. The DOT plays a critical role in moving the public day to day, point A to point B, throughout the state.
I think it's exacerbated in the western region. You have the 33 and the 90 interchange, I could go on and on, the 198, the 90, 190. Every region of the state has a similar set of circumstances as it pertains to DOT thoroughfares and thruway authority thoroughfares. How do you see your partnership moving forward with these other agencies, and can you comment on really what you've been doing and how you see it moving forward?
Well, DOT is the agency we work with the most in terms of our considerations for our capital planning and the projects that we work in, because again, it's all connected, right? Thruway to state roads to local roads. We work with them and the state police, certainly in terms of emergencies and weather, particularly in western New York, that's always an issue. So we work with all those agencies cooperatively, collaboratively, in terms of our projects and how we plan for the future. Again, MTA, Port, and the Bridge Authority are tolling entities, so we work with them to stay on top of things and to on these issues, bridge hits, scoff laws, fare evaders, fare toll evaders for us. So that's ongoing. In fact, we have a cooperation agreement with the Bridge Authority again, is subject of legislation from April of 2020 that we continue to work with them to achieve efficiencies and economies. So those are all our partners. Obviously, state police plays a big role, and we spend $70 million on the state police for the services that they provide. Just keeping it going every day in terms of operation and maintenance, and then when we have emergencies, that work continues.
Thank you. You mentioned bridges. Recently, the horrific, tragic loss of the Francis Scott Key Bridge in Baltimore that collapsed when a cargo ship lost power really brought to light the need for infrastructure investment and, keeping our system up to date, keeping it in line with the structural integrity that the traveling public deserves and that we want to make sure that they get. How do you prioritize the repair and reconstruction of bridges as you see fit? And I also want to ask you if you could just comment on the Grand Island bridges, which I think we were all very excited about the recent announcement that we worked with you and the governor, Senator Schumer, Senator Gillibrand, in delivering tens of millions of dollars to ensure the structural integrity moving forward of the Grand Island bridges. But those are two of many bridges that the Thruway Authority oversees. Can you speak to the integrity of the bridges and how you go about prioritizing that?
Yes, so the Thruway is, as you referred, 2,800 lane miles on its 570-mile long system. 817 bridges span the Thruway. And then there's the Cuomo Bridge in Westchester Rockland, the Grand Island Bridge, and then the Castleton Bridge right outside and east of here, right? So those are the bigger ones. So those are by the numbers. The way we prioritize is that there's biennial, pursuant to federal regulation, there's biennial inspections. Every 2 years, every single bridge in the state has to be inspected, and we work with the DOT on that as well. Mm-hmm. They're inspected, the roads are continuously inspected, so when we come up with our capital plan, that's why it's so important to push this money into the capital program, we prioritize based on need. What stretch needs immediate attention in terms of repaving or reconstruction? What are the bridges that need immediate help? Again, it's right with those numbers, 817 bridges and 2,800 lane miles, right? We're never done, right? We do one piece of roadway, we do one bridge, and it's on to the next, mm-hmm, right? Mm-hmm. And that's been exasperated the last 2 years too with bridge hits. We are in this plague of bridge hits that then make us change or have make us change our priorities or have to rework the schedule of repairs. There's one just south of Senator, you know, south of New Paltz back in January that had to come down. It costs about between $700,000 and $800,000 to take down a bridge, and then about $6 million to repair it, so, to put in a new one, or substantial repairs. So in the last 3 years, we've had last 11 months, we've had three bridge hits that were not in our original plan. Now that we have to adjust and come up with that money, so we prioritize based on those needs, on those inspections, what needs to be done, what has to be addressed sooner than later. And that's why we have a capital plan that looks out 5 years to make sure that those needs are being met, to make sure that we're taking in all four regions of our state, the throwaway is four divisions. So to make sure that they're being addressed holistically throughout the state. Specifically in regard to the Baltimore tragedy, the governor ordered an immediate review of that. We've been looking at our infrastructure and how we address that. We're fortunate that neither Grand Island nor Castleton nor the Cuomo Bridge sees the traffic that the Port of Baltimore sees, or sees the height of those and the size of those ships. But the Cuomo Bridge has been built. It's new, so it's built with the latest technology. We have 24/7 security monitoring there, both of the roadway, but of the water. Cameras on there, the latest technology to detect something amiss in the water channel. It's a very wide channel right there under the Cuomo Bridge. And we are regularly in contact with the Coast Guard to deal with that. It was also built with steel, basically bumpers, so that if a ship did go off course, run aground, that it would deflect it, and the main span would not get that type of a hit that happened in Baltimore. Mm-hmm. Grand Island, we're looking at part of the federal grant addresses that, will address that, will enable us to address that, I should say, that luckily doesn't get a lot of traffic, commercial traffic, and when it does, we work with the Coast Guard through that channel there. Mm-hmm. And Skodak, again, we've part of the reconstruction there. We're adding some technology and looking to add that, you know, those steel type of bumpers to prevent anything like that happening.
Thank you very much. I want to recognize Senator Cooney, who's joined us as well. Thank you, Senator. Obviously, you're overseeing already in your role today and soon to be confirmed in relation to the men and women that run the agency. Can you talk about your approach for managing that workforce? And on a separate note, a lot of attention has been rightfully given to improving the safety of the workers on the highway, including measures passed by this committee and ultimately our legislature signed into law by the governor. How do you envision maintaining and improving the safety of our highway workers? So sort of twofold, all about the workers.
All about the workers. Safety is paramount concern. Again, we want to make sure that when people come to work in the morning, they go home to their families at the end of the day. The work zone safety pilot that you all passed has been effective. We have seen over 42,000 violations issued just from last May to March, and of those, so over 36,000 people are paying. So we've seen slowdowns in work zones. People are paying attention to it. There is a group of folks who don't slow down, are repeat offenders, right? So we are again doing everything we can to enforce that program. Again, it's not about making money. It was never about making money. It was about safety. Mm-hmm. And we have seen people slow down. We've seen less accidents or incidents in our work zone. So that's been a great help. In terms of day-to-day, we are constantly monitoring that. We constantly have safety briefings, and folks, before they go out in any project on the highway, there's a safety brief. They review protocols. Again, try and use technology to make it as safe as possible to be out there.
Thank you. Any other questions? Senator Cooney.
Well, thank you, Chairman, and sorry for being a few minutes late. I was driving safely. But thank you, Director, for your leadership, and I appreciate all the good communication coming out of the Thruway Authority this past year on a number of issues. Since it's certainly on my mind and perhaps some of my colleagues' minds, just curious to know of any challenges that the Thruway may have experienced yesterday with the increased traffic due to eclipse visitors coming into the state. Were there any issues, hopefully nothing serious, would have read about that this morning, but that you experienced in ways that we can improve moving forward?
I think the messaging went out. We were discussing it earlier. Traffic was up Saturday and Sunday, 15% I think on Saturdays, 10% on Sunday, so we saw those increased volumes. But it was actually down on Monday by about 10% between Rochester and Buffalo. So presumably folks listen to the messaging about if you don't have to be out on the road, don't. But that was the result. Yesterday was I think the success was the result of about a year of preparation between 30 state agencies and authorities. So the Thruway was out there prepared. We required the service areas to increase the amount of food and fuel that they brought in to be prepared. We put a ban on long tandem tractor trailers yesterday from originally 6 a.m. to Monday to 6 a.m. Tuesday. Happy to say we were able to relieve that last night at 10 p.m. because of the condition of the roads. So I think the preparation worked and the messaging worked. So we did not see any major any incidents. And as I monitored in the operations center all day yesterday. I mean, there were times in the afternoon that the service areas were fairly empty, and we were prepared. We had state troopers and maintenance and safety personnel out at those places because we were to keep traffic moving. But they were empty. Folks did not, in the month leading up to, we get calls like, can we camp in the service area? Can we use grills and things like that? But that didn't happen at the service areas or eight.
That's because Roxanne was here.
there were eight service areas and the Niagara Welcome Center out in that area. They did not see that traffic. So we got hit the heaviest last night between 10:30 and 12:30 a.m.
Oh, wow.
Because it was in this area, because it was folks coming down from Plattsburgh, and they came down this way, and they either then got on the Thruway 90 west or 87 south. So I'm told in the Baltimore service area, just south of here, was very busy into the early morning hours yesterday. So again, nothing, our fears about people pulling over on the side of the road didn't happen.
That's great.
So that's it.
Thank you.
Senator Fernandez.
What about the earthquake? Because we saw, if I missed that question earlier, we saw on Long Island, the highways were very full, people did pull over. Like, what was the effect that day, and how did you manage?
We were, the protocols and rules are that within 60 miles of the epicenter, we had to go out and inspect. So we spent Friday. There were 86 bridges in that zone going into the Mid-Hudson Valley, and of course the Cuomo Bridge. So we spent Friday. Our folks spent Friday going out and looking at those 86 bridges and the Cuomo Bridge to inspect, and we completed that by the end of the day. Thankfully, there were no damage, no soil movements, or all the things that they look for. So we were very lucky in that. I didn't get any reports of people pulling over on that. I think as you got up our way, it was less known, but that's how we spent Friday. Friday was a more hectic day for us and for me than actually yesterday was with the earthquake. But the governor mobilized folks right away. Again, so that was our role, and that was the 86 bridges and the Cuomo Bridge and the road, about 150 miles of roadway that had to be inspected.
Wonderful. Any other questions? All right. Thank you so much, Mr. Hoare. And I just want to, first and foremost, thank you again, not just for your service to the Thruway Authority, but to the state over many years, decades, and your service again to the country, your leadership. I'm really pleased that the governor would put forward such a credible and distinguished candidate to fill this role moving forward. I'm certainly supportive of you in this moment. And with that, I'd like to advance the nomination of Francis G. Hoare as Executive Director of the Thruway Authority. We have a motion from Senator Prasad, a second from Senator Fernandez, and Cooney, and Hinchy, and Lou. With that, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? None. This item carries. The nomination now is going to advance to finance. And with that, congratulations.
Thank you all.
That completes the business of the day for the Transportation Committee. Thanks, everybody, for being here.